Why we are here to worship a risen Lord. As we do that, shall we bow for a word of prayer? Our Heavenly Father, we want to thank and praise you for your gift to us in Jesus Christ, the one who came into the world to save us from our sins, the one whose sacred head was wounded on our behalf, and whose life was given as a ransom for many. We commend this service and ourselves to you in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you to turn to hymn number 61. We'll sing just the first stanza of O Sacred Head, Now Wounded. He is risen. Lord is name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near and confess our sins unto the Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help. I said I would confess my transgressions unto the Lord. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess unto you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. Wherefore we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy, seeking and imploring your grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. O merciful God, who has given your only begotten Son to die for us, have mercy upon us, and for his sake grant us remission of all our sins, and by your Holy Spirit increase in us true knowledge of you and of your will, and true obedience to your word, that by your grace we may come
to everlasting life.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy upon us and has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. To them that believe on his name, he gives power to become the sons of God and bestows upon them his Holy Spirit. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, O Lord, unto us all. O God, who for our redemption gave your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross, and upon thy glorious resurrection has delivered us from the power of the enemy, grant us to die daily unto sin, that we may evermore live with him who died and rose again for us through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns for all eternity. The Lord have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Glory be to God on high.
Father, Almighty, Lord, the only begotten.
The Lord be with you. Father, our God of the resurrection, we look to you and in you find life eternal. For it is in you and you alone. For all of that is done to the honor and glory of your holy name. Amen. You may be seated.
The Old Testament lesson is from Isaiah chapter 53, verses 8 through 12. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. Yet who of his generation protested? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of most people he was punished. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his dead, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life an offering for sin, he will see his offspring and prolong his days, and the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After he has suffered, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong, because he poured out his life unto death and was numbered with his transgressors. For he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. The epistle lesson is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 12 through 22. But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are found to be false witnesses about God, for we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead. But he did not raise him. In fact, the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. Here ends the reading.
The gospel for the day is found in the gospel according to St. Luke. Be reading from chapter 24, beginning with verse 1, continuing in Jesus' name. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, he has arisen. Remember how he told you, while he was still with you in Galilee. The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners to be crucified and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. Let us continue this morning by confessing together our holy Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed, of the Nicene Creed, I'm sorry. I believe in God, one God, the Father, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of the Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He was suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the scriptures and ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Lord, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. I invite you to turn to hymn number 114, Jesus Christ Lay in Death's Strong Bands.
Thank you.
shouldn't smile. But this is one of those hymns we're learning. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, as we pause this morning, we thank you for the good message of that Jesus lives, and that we can be together this Easter morning to celebrate your resurrection, Jesus. And we pray that you would just lead and guide now as I share your word with the congregation. And Father, would you just anoint these words? Will you guide my mouth? Will you guide my mind and heart? And then, Lord Jesus, would you open hearts and minds and ears this morning to hear your word? In Jesus' name I ask it. Amen. Our first year in Bolivia, 49 years ago now, I don't look that old, do I? I thought I was pretty old at the time when we left. It was quite an experience of Lent and Easter. Even though it was 49 years ago, I shall never forget that experience. We were told that we were studying Spanish down in Cochabamba, Bolivia, which is a lower level of as far as altitude is concerned, a big valley, large valley. A beautiful city, and we were told that on Good Friday that it would be quite a procession that would take place in the city of Cochabamba, and we ought to be out to see that. And then we were reminded that on Sunday we would gather together as evangelicals at the Prado, and we'd march down the Prado and go to what's called the Coronilla, which was like a hog's back right in the middle of the city there, where it had the statue to the women of Cochabamba who defended the city against attack. Well, Good Friday, as we were told, the doors of the large church on the main plaza in Cochabamba opened, and out came soldiers carrying a coffin to a cart, and in that coffin was a statue of Jesus. And the people very reverently observed the procession that began there and went through the streets for maybe a couple hours of the parade with muffled drums. And you could hear that all over the city, room. Room, 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 and then the footsteps of the soldiers. And it was a very, very reverent attitude and spectacle, to us a spectacle, because we had never experienced it before. And at the end of the procession was at the church, the cathedral across on the other side of the main square there, and the principal square, I should say. And there they stopped, took the coffin, brought it in to the cathedral, and set it upon I can't pronounce the word. And there then people would go by and observe and pray, and it was a very, very, very reverent time. Sunday morning, we were up before sunrise, rallied down at the Prado, but all the churches were closed, and my heart. But we as evangelicals were going to praise God. And so we did. We marched down, you know, and we were small in a very prominent Catholic community. We were very small, but we were going to declare that Christ is risen. And we marched to the Coronilla, and then went up to the Coronilla, and then had a church service as the sun came up in Cochabamba. It was a special, special day. And I guess that contrast between the two that really helped me understand the impact of the resurrection, that Christ has risen, and we have reason not only to be reverent, but to celebrate. And we do that, if we're doing it right, every Sunday, right? We remember that Jesus is alive. He is resurrected. He lives. Are you doing that today? Come on. Let's celebrate. It's a day of celebration. The resurrection brings life for all to know and experience that God has a plan of salvation. Jesus arose. The stone was rolled away. The tomb was empty. Sin and death has been conquered. Praise God. He is risen. Amen. So I want this morning to be very intentional to declare to you that Jesus is the living Lord resurrected from the dead. The angels asked the women when they came that day, "Why do you seek the living one among the dead?" Jesus is the Lord among the dead, as we confess in the Apostles' Creed. Crucified, dead and buried, he descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. And what does that mean? That means that Jesus, as he descended into hell, did not do so to preach salvation, but he went there to declare his lordship, for he is Lord of heaven, earth, and under the earth. He is Lord of all. He went there to declare and to make his works known. 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 18 and 19 say the following. "For Christ also died for sins once for all, the just for the unjust, in order that he might bring us to God, having been put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which also he went and made proclamation to the spirits now in prison." He went and made proclamation. He went and declared himself Lord over all. You do not need to convince anyone in hell if Jesus is Lord. It's a big problem here on earth because many struggle with that issue, not only as a objective fact, but a personal experience. Also, Paul adds to our understanding when he writes in Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 and following. Listen to what he says, what Peter says. "Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but he emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant, being made in the likeness of men, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue should confess, Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." He speaks of Jesus' Lenten humiliation, his sufferings and death. But then Paul points out to us Jesus' exaltation as Lord to be worshipped here on earth. And also that every knee should bow, every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord. So you see, we have the choice today, but eternity will reveal, and we shall all confess without choice. It shall be done in eternity. Thus says the Lord. Prophetically, the declaration of Jesus is Lord is found way back in the book of Isaiah, chapter 42. And then it's quoted by Paul in Romans chapter 14. where he says in verses 11 and 12, "For it is written," and this is the quote from Isaiah, "As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall give praise to God. To then each one of us shall give account of himself to God." We can say tomorrow, I'll do that, but eventually tomorrow comes. Prophetically, here we have the word of God for us this morning. "So that each one of us shall give account of our responsibility and who God is." Yes, Jesus is the living Lord, resurrected from the dead. It is a truth and it is a reality. Secondly, this morning, God is still rolling away stones. Have you had any stones rolled away lately? I got a big one coming up. What do we have to do tomorrow? Don't you know? Don't you know what tomorrow is? Tomorrow's tax day. I got a big stone. At least for me, it's big. I've been praying. Lord, help Peter, who's doing our taxes. He still hasn't sent me the forms. I hope they come tomorrow so I can send them. It's a big thing. Maybe you'd think of, but we all have our stones. And in the midst of all this, I was fussing and fuming about it, you know, and going through all these things. And then I went, you know, that's why I don't have a whole lot of hair on my head. Norwegians say ufta. This was an ufta moment. Why don't you just turn it over to the Lord? Why don't you just let him roll that stone away? So here I am on Sunday morning, finally getting it. So I'll be patient with you if you don't get it right away. God wants to roll away stones in our lives, those hindrances, those difficulties. And folks, he's able. Why, if you don't get anything else out of these verses, the women who were fussing about it when they left to go to the tomb, who's going to do this? It was already done when they got there. All they had to do is to go in. And they did. And they found the tomb empty. The women would never experience the good news if they had not persisted to go on and not let the problem divert them. That happens to us many times, doesn't it? Oh, this big problem, and I feel so tired, I don't think I'll get up and face it. Rather than to go ahead and see what God's doing. Go ahead and see God at work, changing things for us. And what happens to us? Well, it'll happen to us just like it did to the women. They were in the beginning perplexed, confused, but persistent. And then they were frightened. Wow, what's happening here? And then they were excited. They were left running to tell others of what they had experienced. We have stones of difficulty in our lives. And many times we can't figure out what we should do. We can learn from these women not to quit or give up. We can learn this morning how important it is to know and remember what God has to say. Because what do the two men in white say to them? "He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he spoke to you while you were still in Galilee. Remember what he has given to you. Remember what is in the scriptures. Hold on to these truths. Let them be a part of your life and the guidance of direction. God's purpose is for us to know. It's not some sort of, well, I don't want to be crude about it, but you know, some people kind of give the idea that faith is just running around like a bunch of dummies. That's not true. It's a knowledge base. God comes, he says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Yes, we do need to step by faith. And by faith, we don't always know what's ahead, but God has the plan. We know that in the future, there God is. We learned that in our mission experiences. One of my former roommates back in Bible school, and friend all through college years, and he went off to Brazil in a missionary, and he came back, and he was had back surgery, and I went to see him just before we left for Bolivia. And I said, well, Josh, you know, we're going off to Bolivia now. And he said, well, don't think that you're the first one to get there. Yes. Wherever we go, God has already been there. Think of that. Keep that in mind. When you're at the point of wondering and doubting, when there are things that seem insurmountable, just remember that God is already there. He goes ahead of us. And we need to hear what his word is to us. But also, just remember what the proverb says in Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. What? Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and don't lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him. And then comes the promise. And what is that promise? Anybody know it? That's right. He will direct your paths. Now, either that's the truth or it's a lie. You see, God never leaves it somewhere in between. Just trust him for it. Or seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things will be added unto you. Beginning at the right place. That's with the Lord, that is. We will see many stones rolled away. I'll guarantee you that. Thirdly, this morning, the resurrection message needs to be told. It needs to be told. Jesus broke into the hopelessness of a world fallen in sin. So God the Father breaks into the hopelessness of the women that day, and the disciples who didn't even bother to go up and go to the tomb. And how did he do that? Through heavenly messengers. We have the word of God. Why look for the living one? Did you catch that? Why look for the living one among the dead? The tomb is empty. There's no body here. And remember, he spoke to you. These women came with one plan, but they left with another. And you know what's really interesting? In the various gospels, it talks about how they had spices and all these things to treat the body of Christ. But you know, once the announcement was made, nothing is mentioned at all about the spices. But it does mention about them returning and telling others. The motive had changed. There was the necessity that others needed to know what happened. They couldn't keep that good news to themselves. It just had to flow forth out of their being. These women, because they followed through with going to the tomb, had a message of life to be given. The power of sin had been conquered because the tomb is empty and Jesus is not among the dead. That is life. And that is the message of the Christian church, the message of life. Death has been conquered because Jesus is the victor. That's life. Easter morning, 49 years ago, it's a time to declare in the city of Cochabamba, Bolivia, that Jesus is risen and alive, and I can assure you that they are making that announcement this day as well. Easter experiences have varied for us over the years. 49 years. And they've been varied. You know what? I think it was 50 years. I think my Minnesota math is kind of bad. I think it's 50 years ago. Huh. I better go back and check that. The message is the same. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
It needs to be told to the whole world. To the whole world. We've got a story to tell to the nations. The last stanza of that hymn, we've a Savior to show to the nations. Who the path of sorrow has trod, that all the world's great peoples might come to the truth of God. Might come to the truth of God. For the darkness, do you know it? Turn to the dawning and to noonday light. And Christ's great kingdom shall come upon earth. The kingdom of love and life and life. Amen. Thank you, Jesus, for the message of the resurrection. And I thank you that I can proclaim that this morning, and I thank you that we can hear that message this morning from you. It is your message to us. Truly, we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Can't find my bulletin here. What number is it? 97, hymn number 97. I can't know what I did with my... Here it is.
I know that I'm redeemed.
continue this morning by worshiping the Lord with our tithes and offerings. Upon the altar this morning, we ask that you would just bless the gift and the giver to the honor of your name. Amen. You may be seated, and we'll continue by turning to hymn number 107, He is Risen, Glorious Word. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is meet and right so to
you. It is truly meet, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." After the same manner also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "This cup is a new testament in my blood, which is shed for you and for many, for the remission of sins. This do as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me." I invite you to bow in prayer and have some personal prayer time, and then we will continue by praying together the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you. This morning we will be inviting the confirmants and family to come forward to the first table, and then the ushers will wait upon you following that. Welcome to the Lord's table this morning.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, for that you have refreshed us with this, your salutary gift. And we ask you of your mercy to strengthen us through the same gift in faith towards you and in fervent love toward one another through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bless we the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I believe it's 281 we sing in closing. I invite you to stand if you're able. 95, sorry about that. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.